simple prayer. Say it with me. I wanna be where you are. Say, I gotta be where you are. Let's do it together. Say, I wanna be where you are. Yeah. I gotta be where you are. Oh. I wanna be where you are. Yes, Lord. I've gotta be where. I wanna be where. Thank you.
Good morning, church. The psalmist says, I will bless the Lord at all times. We say that often. We say that. What is the psalmist talking about when he says, I will bless the Lord at all times? Really, the psalmist is saying, I'll give God thanks because of how good God is. And I've discovered that God is good, not just because God does things for us, not just because God makes ways for us. The Lord is good because when you need the Lord to do it, the Lord will put his hands on you. He'll touch you. Anybody need a touch from God today? Anybody need a touch from God today? We're going to sing about that right now. Touch me, Lord Jesus.
Jesus. Turn your neighbor and say, I just want to be touched by Jesus. I know my daddy back in Ohio, you got to be a certain age to kind of know that kind of music right there, but we got a special section. Stay right there. Number B. Remember the old days we used to do an A and a B? We're going to go back and hit a song that says, no, not one. There's not a friend. Come on, y'all.
Our hands together for the Lord this morning. There is not a friend like the lowly Jesus. Amen. Just a reminder, we had a great turnout for the first children's choir rehearsal. Their choir rehearsal practice times are in the emails that went out on Friday, as well as the Mass Choir. Mass Choir will be singing on Easter Sunday, fifth Sunday, and so we encourage everybody who's part of the music ministry or maybe has been waiting to be a part of the music ministry, come on out to the Mass Choir rehearsal for Easter Sunday morning. And with that in mind, the Holy Week schedule here at Union will be, we'll have, of course, Palm Sunday worship next Sunday morning. You can believe it, we are already there. Palm Sunday morning, Palm Sunday service next Sunday morning. Monday, Thursday service, where we celebrate the Last Supper Jesus had with his disciples, will be Thursday the 28th at 7 p.m. And we will come back on that next day, Friday, for the Good Friday service that will be at noon. Will be at noon. And we look forward to seeing you there. And then we will be back here ready to rejoice on the fifth Sunday, March 31st, 9:30 a.m. for Easter Sunday service as we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I don't know about you, but I'm ready to get him up out of the grave. Amen, as we celebrate the goodness of God. Also, mark your calendars for Saturday, April the 6th. There will be a community event here at Union Baptist Church, right here in the sanctuary. It is a screening, a viewing of a documentary by Charles Blow. Some of you may know the name. He is a columnist for the New York Times and a contributor to MSNBC. And the documentary is called South to Black Power. It's an event to promote voting awareness and participation in the community. So anyone and everyone is welcome. It will be organized by a brother named James Folk, who may be with us this morning. Not sure. Amen. God bless you, brother. Amen. Let's give God praise for Brother James Folk. And we are grateful for the opportunity to share because we do know these are critical times. We say it all the time, but these are critical times. And so you cannot vote if you aren't registered, and you won't know how to vote if you aren't informed. So come on out Saturday, April the 6th, and there'll be more information about that in the coming weeks in the weekly emails. But share it with your friends and family so we can fill up the sanctuary and certainly let people know what is going on. We thank you in advance for your generosity. We praise you for your faithfulness, and you make so much possible. I say it all the time, but every week I hear a different story about how somebody's been blessed by the generosity of Union Baptist Church, and so we're grateful to God for your consistency in your giving. God says, bring all the tithe into the storehouse so there may be resources, food in my house, and see if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you will not have room enough to receive. Would you stand today as we give God thanks for God's gifts to us and the opportunity to give back to the Lord? Let us pray. God, we thank and praise you this morning. We know that we can't live and we can't move unless you give us the power to do so. We thank you for last night. We thank you for this morning. You have put food on our tables. You've put clothes on our backs and allowed us to be able to meet here at the house of worship one more time. And so, God, receive these gifts that we bring in your name and use them for the upbuilding and the advancement of your kingdom. May somebody's life be changed and blessed and saved simply because of our faithfulness to you. This we pray and ask in Jesus' name, and the people of God who love God said amen.
everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
How many know we serve an amazing God? He's wonderful and marvelous in all of his ways. Do I have a witness this morning? Do you serve an amazing God?
Lord, I'm
thank you, Lord. Oh God, all power belongs to you. You are amazing. Amen, amen, amen. Good morning, Union. Good morning. Our scripture this morning is Psalm 119, verses 9 through 16, and I will be reading the NIV version. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips, I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. Final verse says, I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. Would you bow and would you pray with me? Eternal and everlasting God, our Father, God, our creator and our sustainer, God, our all and all and everything, oh God, we say thank you for your amazing love. Thank you, oh God, for the love that brought Jesus down into this low ground of sorrow to save us from ourselves, God. We thank you for your word this morning, God. We thank you for your precepts, oh God. We thank you that we, your children, Lord God, hide your word in our hearts that we might not sin against you. Thank you for the word and the word made flesh. Thank you, oh God, for all the many wonderful blessings, Lord God, that you have bestowed upon us. We, your children, say thank you. We bless you this morning, oh God, and give you glory, honor, and praise. We ask that you forgive us, Lord, of the times when we didn't do right. Forgive us, Lord, of the times that we said something that we should not have said, God. Forgive us for sins of omission and commission, God, in the name of Jesus. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us as we endeavor, oh God, to walk this walk of faith, as we stretch our hands to you, Lord God, for you, hallelujah, are our all and all and our everything. We lift up those who are sick in our number today. We lift up those, oh God, who are bereaved right now in the name of Jesus. We know that you are a comforter, oh God. Wrap them in your ever-loving arms, oh God, and rock them and comfort them as they go through their season of bereavement. We thank you, oh God, for every ministry in this church. We thank you, oh God, for our pastor this morning. We pray mightily, oh God, a fresh anointing on his life. Continue to bless his children and his wife, Lord God. Continue, Lord God, to do the work that you have started to do in Union Baptist Church. We know there are greater things yet to come, oh God, and we look forward, hallelujah, because we know that eye has not seen, oh God, nor ear heard what you yet have in store for those of us who love you and who are the called according to your purpose. God, there's so many things that we can pray for. We know that you know everything, oh God, and we lift those silent prayers that have not been uttered, those things that are in our hearts that we have not shared, and we give you glory, honor, and praise for all that you've done, Lord God, all that you're going to do, hallelujah, in the days to come. We continue to trust you, for you are our God, and oh God, you are amazing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Anybody ready to worship in this place? We come to give God all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Hallelujah. We've been changed in his presence. In his presence, there's fullness of joy. There's love. There's peace. Whatever you need, it's in his presence this morning. Come on, if you believe it, open up your mouth and shout, hallelujah. We worship you. We worship you. Deliver, I found you. joy, peace, grace, and favor.
I've been healed.
Come on, say free.
Free.
Deliver.
Deliver.
think one of the things that makes that song so powerful is that even if we can't sing it in the past tense, we can sing about what we want to happen tomorrow. I want to be able to say, I have been changed. I'm being changed. That means everybody ought to be able to sing it. God has changed some things, but God is changing all things. So we give God our thanks and we give God our praise. Amen. I know some of us come from a different generation. You might say, I looked at my hands, and my hands look new. Amen. Let me put this right here. Amen. We're gonna talk a little bit. God is in the changing business. Together for the Lord this morning. Amen, amen. Let's thank God for the music ministry at Union Baptist Church. Amen. Thank you, ushers and greeters and all of those working behind the scenes in the AV room. Amen. Not to call out one person, but we've got somebody new with us today, and Reverend, I'm going to say it like this, the Reverend soon-to-be Dr. Joe Robbins is playing on the organ today, and so we're grateful for him. Fifth Sunday in Lent, as we walk through this series, and Mark, the King is here. Text today is Mark chapter 9, starting at verse 14. It's a long passage, but it is worth hearing the whole thing, 14 through 29. When they came to the other disciples, they saw a large crowd around them and the teachers of the law arguing with them. As soon as all the people saw Jesus, they were overwhelmed with wonder and ran to greet him. What are you arguing about? What are you arguing with him about? He asked. A man in the crowd answered, Teacher, I brought you my son, who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not. You unbelieving generation, Jesus replied, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me. So they brought him. When the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the boy's father, how long has he been like this? From childhood, he answered. It has often thrown him into fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. If you can, said Jesus, everything is possible for the one who believes. Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. When Jesus saw that a crowd was running to the scene, he rebuked the impure spirit. You deaf and mute spirit, he said, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. The spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet, and he stood up. After Jesus had gone indoors, his disciples asked him privately, "Why couldn't we drive it out?" He replied, "This kind can come out only by prayer." Let us pray. Loving and all-wise God, we are grateful and glad to be in your presence this morning. We pray now for your word to come alive once again by the power of your Spirit. And so those in the sanctuary and those watching us, worshiping with us virtually, God, we pray that you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear. Take your servant now and hide him, that the people might see less of him and more of you. This we pray in Jesus' name, and the people of God said amen. Overcoming unbelief. Overcoming unbelief. When I was in my early teenage years, my family went on a trip. It's a big trip to the West Coast. I think my dad had some business travel, and my oldest sister was about to go off to college, and he knew this would be the last time that we probably would go anywhere together, all six of us as a family. And one of the attractions that I knew of and wanted to see with my own eyes was a place called Ripley's Believe It or Not. I was a child, so please don't judge my taste in entertainment. Now, I do know that if my dad was anything like I am today, and some of you know this, I am sure he did not really want to spend his hard-earned money at one of the biggest tourist traps known to humankind. But he took us anyway. Ripley's, Believe It or Not, started as a newspaper column, and then it became a radio program. Eventually, it was a brick-and-mortar attraction, something like what you might see, one of those over-the-top colorful places at the Boardwalk in Myrtle Beach or Gatlinburg, Tennessee. It was started 105 years ago. He presented the public, Robert Ripley did, with events and stories and items so bizarre and strange that he then asked the public to decide for themselves whether it was real or make-believe. How bizarre were these things? Well, you might see the skeleton of what was supposed to be a mermaid in a glass. You might see the statue of a man that was allegedly 9 feet tall. There are always artifacts from places like Africa and South America, because Ripley knew that Americans looked at those places as unusual and exotic. And as a child, it's not always easy to tell fact from fiction. But one thing I remember is that at the end of every Ripley presentation, you'd always hear the same phrase, "You can believe it or not." And given what we know from science today, nobody expects you to believe in mermaids or Bigfoot. Well, maybe Bigfoot, but verdict is still out. Either way, your life won't really change whether you believe or do not believe. You can be a mermaid, believer or unbeliever, and it will not impact your life whatsoever. But when we don't believe in things that matter, it changes everything. Don't let somebody else's rejection of you make you stop believing in yourself. Don't let a corrupt politician or a greedy preacher make you stop believing in democracy or the goodness of the church. Don't let a bad relationship keep you from believing in good relationships. Don't allow failure to keep you from believing that success is within your grasp. Whatever we do, we can't stop believing in the things that really matter. That's the issue that we come into in Mark chapter 9. Our unbelief in God can inhibit or impede how we experience the power of God. Throughout Mark, Jesus puts the power of God on full display. Certainly, God is full of compassion. God is full of mercy. But at the same time, do not forget that God is a God full of power. God has the power to call us. God has power over impure spirits. God has the power to reverse human weakness. God has the power to forgive sins, the power to deliver us from evil spirits, the power to calm storms, and even the power to raise the dead back to life. God is a God of power, church. I ask the question about whether we believe this or not, because unbelief inhibits our access to that power. It's not that unbelief renders God powerless. We are not that powerful. Rather, our unbelief blocks our access to God's power, our trust in God's power. In our unbelief, we turn to other sources for help. And we never see that God really can deliver us. In our unbelief, we rely on our own strength. We try to produce our own solutions. In our unbelief, we devise our own schemes. We never see that God has ways that are not like our ways. When we overcome unbelief, however, we discover that there is no power that compares to the power of God. You don't have to take my word for this. In the Gospel of Mark, person after person found out that Jesus had more power than they could ever imagine. Jesus had the power to walk on water. He had the power to be full of himself. He had the power to heal blind men. It's good to know that God is wise. It's good to know that God is merciful. It's good to know that God is patient. But often in my day-to-day life, and maybe it's true for you, what I need to know is I've got a God who is a God of power, a God of liberating power, a God of delivering power, a God of healing power, a God of saving power, a God with blessing power, a God with turn things around power, a God with mountain moving power, and a God with prayer answering power. We've got a God who is a God of power. So consider this demonstration of power that Jesus puts on display in Mark 9. First of all, he has just come back, just returned from a short getaway with three of his disciples. Peter, James, and his brother John. The four of them went to a mountain, and they were all alone. No crowds, no Pharisees, no scribes. You know, it's good to get away sometimes. God speaks to us in solitude. God moves in our life in solitude. Therefore, it is not surprising that at the apex of this mountain, something miraculous took place. Jesus, it says, was transfigured before them. We didn't read this part. It's right before our text. It says his appearance changed. His clothes became dazzling white. Mark doesn't give us all the details about how Jesus looked different, because I told you in week one that Mark is not very big on details. He doesn't give us detailed explanations and background. He says what he has to say, and then he moves on. What we know is that there appeared among them two people from Israel's history, Elijah and Moses, and they were talking to Jesus, who was being transfigured right before their eyes. Elijah and Moses had been dead for a very long time, so these were not people, not images that the disciples expected to see. In fact, the moment was so special to Peter that he did not want to leave. He came up with what he thought was a bright idea. He suggested, hey, let's build three shelters, three tabernacles, three tents, one for you, Jesus, one for Elijah, and one for Moses. Then we can keep all of you around. We never have to let you go. Peter was beside himself. He really didn't know what to say. And that's the best he could come up with at the time. But then a cloud appeared and covered them. And a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved son whom I love. Listen to him." This was not the first time that the voice of God had spoken in a cloud. It happened when John the Baptist baptized Jesus in the Jordan River. Go back to week one or week two, whenever that was. But at the time, the voice spoke to Jesus. When John baptized Jesus, it spoke to Jesus and not to the people. The voice then said, "Jesus, you are my beloved son whom I love." That was for Jesus' benefit. But now the voice is speaking to the disciples. "This is my beloved son whom I love. Listen to him." The voice wasn't for Jesus this time. Now it's for the disciples. It's for all of us that I need you to know who he is. The whole episode follows a familiar pattern that we see in the Bible, because mountains are places where people go to meet with God. Moses did it. Elijah did it. Clouds sometimes represent the presence of God. And this experience was God's way of confirming exactly who Jesus said he was, the Son of Man that had authority and power to be who he was. But as we see and have seen so often in Mark, words are not enough. When Jesus wants you to know who he is, you can expect some evidence and some demonstration of that in your life. You don't have to rely on hearsay. You don't have to rely on secondhand information. If you want to know who Jesus is, just look at the evidence. Have you experienced God's goodness in your life? That's some evidence for you. Have you ever looked back on your life only to realize how close you were to danger, but it did not take you out? Maybe that's your evidence. Have you ever had a problem that you could not solve, and God, in God's own way, in God's own time, worked it out better than you could imagine? That's evidence that God is working in your life. So after that mountaintop moment, Jesus brought some more evidence of who he was. He said, I'm going to show you by word and by deed. And the evidence comes starting in verse 14, because as soon as they came back down from the mountain, they ran into a problem. Amen, somebody. Let me take a momentary pause right here, because isn't this how things are for us too? As soon as we come down from a high spiritual moment, we encounter the interruptions of everyday life. As soon as we walk out of the sanctuary on Sunday morning, somebody's calling our phone with some bad news. As soon as we finish our morning devotion, as soon as we leave Sunday school, as soon as we leave Bible study, as soon as we have a worship moment in our car, somebody cuts us off and makes us go back to the old ways of talking that we thought we... Oh, come on, somebody. Help us, Holy Spirit. According to verse 14, Jesus saw a large crowd gathered around him and gathered around the 9 disciples that did not go to the mountain. And the crowd and the disciples were arguing. Mark says, as soon as the crowd saw Jesus, however, they were overwhelmed with wonder and ran to greet him. That struck me, church. I know I've read this text many, many times, but the fact that they were overwhelmed with wonder struck me as something significant, because as we're about to get past the halfway point in Mark, and there'll be no more moments like this. Soon there'll be a crowd that will gather around Jesus and yell to those in charge, crucify him, crucify him. But right now, the people are overjoyed by the hope that Jesus offers them. And when they saw him, they were overwhelmed with wonder and they ran to greet him. And I think this is part of overcoming our unbelief, and that is, to overcome unbelief, we've got to come to God with a sense of wonder. Don't miss this, church. The poet Lucille Clifton said that poems are about wonder. Poetry is about wonder. And I want to give you a spiritual repackaging of that, because I think to really understand who God is, you have to come to God with a sense of wonder. Sometimes we come to God to analyze God. We want to put God under a microscope to figure God out and see what makes God tick. Sometimes we come to God to critique God. We don't like this and we don't like that. We come to shake our fist at God and demand that God answers our questions. Sometimes we come to God with utter and complete confusion. But something amazing happens when we come to God with a sense of wonder. Something happens when we read the scripture with a sense of wonder, not like we already know what it says. Something happens when we come into worship with a sense of wonder. Mark says that when Jesus showed up, his presence filled the people with wonder. And to move from unbelief to belief, we've got to have a sense of wonder. This might not be the point you were expecting, but I think it's the point we need, because so much tries to grab our attention these days that we can lose our sense of wonder when it comes to who God is. Today, a video game will go viral because a cat did something cute. People are amazed at the cat. They're astounded by the cat. They share the videos of the cat. They say, look, honey, look at what this cat did. People are filled with wonder because of a feline. They share it. They like it. They repost it. But in the end, it's just a cat. Oh, but when I think about the goodness of my God, Miles, give me a little bit more on the monitor here. God is not an ordinary God. God is an extraordinary God. God is not an average God. God is an exceptional God. God is not a routine God. God is a remarkable God. I'm going to tell you this. God made the cat. God made the mind that made the technology, that made the video of the cat. God made the eyes that watched the video, and God put the brain in our head to process it and gave you a voice to laugh at the video. But we can act like the creature is more wonderful than the creator. Sometimes we've got to show up with God and say, God, you are amazing. I've never known anybody like you. Your love is amazing. Your joy is amazing. Your peace is amazing. You are a wonderful, awesome, marvelous God. Oh, you are wonderful to me. When was the last time we got filled with wonder because of God? Sometimes unbelief grows when we have a God who is too small. Too small to amaze us, too small. There's so much happening in our life and in our world that it's hard to stop long enough to observe and just take in the goodness of God. And then little by little, it can chip away at our belief. It's hard to trust a God that does not amaze you. So here's the homework for you. When you leave the building today, I want to challenge you to do something. When you go outside, it's a nice sunny day, I think, look up and just take in the vast expanse of the sky. Think about how small you are, how small we are, and how big the world is. And then think about the words of Psalm 19, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the skies proclaim the work of his hands. Tonight, when you go to bed, before you drift off to sleep, I want you to look back over the God's blessings on your life and think about Psalm 105, verse 5, that says, remember the wonders he has performed, his miracles and the rulings he has given. And if that does not give you a sense of wonder, when you wake up tomorrow morning, if you wake up tomorrow morning, because tomorrow is not promised, I want you to turn to Ephesians 1 and 3 and think about the blessings that God has put in your life. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for he has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. All of these in their own way push us to have God, a sense of wonder in our minds. Why is that? Because they tell us that God's knowledge is wonderful, and God's counsel is wonderful, and God's love is wonderful, and God's mercy is wonderful, and God's name is wonderful. Everything about God is full of wonder, and the more that I am filled with wonder, the more I can shake hold of unbelief. The people ran to greet Jesus because they were filled with wonder. And Jesus said, what are y'all arguing about? And said, well, y'all can't fool me. That's what he knew there was a problem. And at that moment, a man in the crowd answered, teacher, I brought you my son, who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive it out, but they could not. The problem is not really difficult to see. The father had a son who was possessed by a spirit. The spirit rendered the son unable to speak. It gave him seizures. The father thought Jesus might be able to do something, so he brought the son to Jesus. However, Jesus was on the mountain with Peter, James, and John, and since Jesus was not around, the father said, well, you disciples, you are his disciples. I want you to heal my son. And this is God's notice to us. And the churches everywhere, people expect the church to do what Jesus did. The father had a right to expect the disciples to help him. Mark 3:15 says Jesus gave the disciples authority to cast out demons. Mark 6 and 7 says, Jesus called the 12 to him and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over impure spirits. Mark 6, 13 says, the disciples went out and drove out many demons and anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. So the Father's request was not unreasonable. If Jesus wasn't there, the disciples should have been able to do what he asked them to do. Any of us ought to be able to identify with this Father. He was struggling to believe, and he was unafraid, this is the good news, to tell Jesus that he struggled. He said, I believe, help my unbelief. See, church, belief is not just about knowledge. It's not just about doctrine. Belief is ultimately about trust. Do I trust that God is good? Do I trust that God cares? Do I trust that God loves me and God is committed to me even when I have missed the mark? This father had a son who was sick, and we know from personal experience, don't we, that trauma and tragedy can shake our belief, can disrupt our ability to trust in God. Losing a job, losing our health, a breakup or a heartbreak, losing a loved one, seeing people that we care about suffer, our own health in decline, watching the wicked prosper. All of these experiences can test our trust in God, and with enough pressure and enough pain, we start to pull back instead of lean in. We start to drift away instead of drawing near. So when I see this desperate father, it seems to me that he did something we need to do, and that is, even though he struggled to believe, he took action that was consistent with faithful expectation. Even though he didn't know if he believed, he still showed up because he knew that was the faithful thing to do. He took action that was consistent with faithful expectation. He was struggling to believe, but he made the right choice. Church, I say this because despite his obvious struggle to believe, he brought his son to Jesus. Jesus said, bring the boy to me, and they brought him. And I tell you, it's good to know that Jesus has time for your trouble. Jesus was on his way to give his life as a ransom for the redemption of the entire world, but he made time to stop where he was and say, bring that one child to me. He made space for one person's problem. So often it's easier to talk about loving the whole world than it is about loving the person right there in front of us. We talk about our desire to help humankind, but then we won't do anything for an individual. Jesus said, I'm here for the whole world, but if you've got a problem, I am here for you too. They brought the boy to Jesus, and immediately the boy had another seizure. And Jesus said, how long has it been like this? And from childhood, the father answered, sometimes the seizures throw him into fire and sometimes into water, and he nearly died. And I tell you, I've just got to pause one more time, because somebody ought to be able to testify that you've been thrown to the ground, you've been thrown into some fire, you've been thrown into some water, and you nearly died, but you didn't die. You're still here right now. Lucille Clifton had another poem where she talked about, nearly every day something has tried to kill me, but it failed. I tell you, maybe you almost died. Maybe you should have died. Maybe you could have died, but thanks be to God, you are here right now. God did not see fit to send you out of here, yet you are still alive to praise his name. The boy didn't die, and his father was not about to give up. He brought the son to Jesus. The father struggled with his son, but he brought him to Jesus. He wasn't sure if Jesus could do something, but he made his way to Jesus. He was helpless and almost hopeless, but for him, it was enough to bring him to Jesus, because he said, even though I'm struggling with my belief, I'm still going to do this thing, this faithful action. Other people in the scripture looked to Jesus because they knew who he was and they believed what he could do. But the father carried in himself, just like you and me, a mixture of belief and unbelief. He did not know if Jesus could do it. He did not know if Jesus would do it. He did not know if it would happen. I know it sounds like a lot, but here we have in our own lives this mixture of belief and unbelief. On Monday we believe, but then on Tuesday we aren't sure. On payday we believe, but when the bills are due, we just aren't quite sure. But the good news is this, church, our faith does not need to be perfect in order for God to use it. our faith does not have to be fully developed for God to do something that is amazing and miraculous and wonderful and incredible. If we've got a little, God can do a lot. If we've got some, God can do something. Because according to Mark 9, even if our faith is weak, God can still work it out. That ought to be good news for somebody today. And somebody else is saying, but preacher, I thought we were supposed to have big faith. Well, big faith is good, but the size of your faith is not the most important thing about faith. The object of your faith or the focus of your faith is what really matters. That's why Jesus said, bring the boy to me. Take him out of your hands and put him in my hands. Break him out of that mess you're in and give him to me. The breakthrough is in me. The deliverance is in me. The answer is in me. If even we have the smallest faith, but put it in him, that's enough for him to do more than we can ask or imagine. Father brought his son to Jesus. He had a mixture of faith and or rather belief and unbelief. So as long as we put our trust in the right place, there's no telling what the Lord will do. But finally, beloved, what is interesting about this passage is that Jesus does not rebuke the Father. He rebukes the disciples. He rebukes the disciples because they should have believed but did not. He had compassion on the Father because the Father struggled to believe and confessed his unbelief. So if you miss anything else in this message, please know that there is no disgrace in your doubts. Doubts do not disqualify you from God's point of view. We can be quick to criticize other Christians, especially younger adults who have questions and they have doubts. Well, to them, we tell them not to question anything about God. We fuss at them for arguing with God. But maybe the questions and the doubts are really just part of the process. Most of the people, in fact, that we praise in the scripture for being so great and so faithful had a doubt or a question somewhere along the way. They did not go from start to finish without having to work through some things and get through some things and deal with the questions that popped up along the way. In their own way, they all said, I believe, but help my unbelief. Jeremiah cursed the day that he was born, and Jeremiah was a prophet called by God. Job wondered how he could live a good life and still suffer so much bad news. And Job was a man that was said to trust God. God called a man named Gideon to save his people, but Gideon was reluctant to believe that he was the right man for the job. Dr. Martin Luther King had days when he felt like turning around and quitting and giving up the fight, the good fight. These people trusted in God, but they at times struggled with their own belief. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad that doubt does not disqualify me from God's point of view. Some people think that doubt is even a necessary part of our spiritual growth. They say that without doubt, we'll never change. We'll never question what we think. And then the pride sets in. Because if pride sets in, we'll always have the same ideas about God that we had when we were 7 years old. And so the gift of doubt is that it gives us space to question God and ultimately see more of God with mature spiritual eyes. Then as we grow, we can leave behind our youthful, underdeveloped ideas of who God is. Despite the Father's doubt, he did the one thing that made a difference. He took action that was consistent with expectation. I tell you, despite the Father's doubt, he was still on the right path, because even though he struggled to believe, he was standing in front of the right person that could help him believe. I tell you, Jesus said, bring the boy to me. And then as soon as the impure spirit knew that it was Jesus on the JOB, it threw the boy into a seizure. Now remember that the disciples failed to do what the Father asked them to do. The Father told Jesus, I asked your disciples to help. And since you were not here and they could not help, it's not that they were unwilling, but they were unable. Sometimes people struggle to believe in the goodness of God because they don't see the church doing what the church ought to be able to do. In fact, hold on just a minute. I sat next to a man on a plane last week. He grew up in Europe, and we chatted about this and that. And he told me he lost interest in the church because in his country, the church turned people away when they needed help. In that case, they were able, but they were unwilling. But since he lives in Durham, North Carolina, I told him about the way Union is willing and able to help somebody along the way. But more importantly, church, we've got a God that is both willing and extremely able. And if we stay close to this God, we'll see more of his power. That's where the disciples messed up that day. They asked Jesus why they couldn't cast out that impure spirit. And Jesus said, this kind can only come out by prayer. If we're going to do what God wants us to do, we've got to stay connected to his power. So when the desperate father brought his son to Jesus, he said, if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. And Jesus said, if you can, then he said, everything is possible for the one who believes. Jesus said, everything is possible for the one that puts their trust in me. Because the one who believes is the one that trusts that God is not only willing, but God is also able. Everything may not be guaranteed. Everything may not be the way we want it to be, but everything is possible for the one who believes, the one who trusts in him, the one who waits on him, the one who depends on him, the one who's connected to him. So when you have an impossible task, stay connected to the power. When you have unusual burdens, stay connected to the power. When you have a perplexing problem, stay connected to the power. When you have a need you cannot supply, stay connected to the power. The Bible says that the Spirit shook the boy, shook him so much that folk thought he was dead. But Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he stood up, and he got up, and he rose up. I tell you, the father's prayer was not perfect. His faith was not perfect. But Jesus took that imperfect faith and that imperfect prayer and said, I can put my incredible power right on top of it. And if God ever does something like that, remember, there is no secret to what God can do. It's not about your ability. It's about God's ability. And the last time I checked, God's word never fails. God's mercy never fails. God's forgiveness never fails. God's timing never fails. God's judgment never fails. God's wisdom never fails. It might look impossible, but I tell you, God will have the last word. So whatever is broken, bring it to him. Whatever is falling apart, bring it to him. Whatever you can't handle, bring it to him. There is power in a touch from Jesus. He'll make weakness into strength. He'll turn things around. I believe. I believe. I believe. I believe. I believe. Sometimes our faith is imperfect, but we're thinking about our own ability instead of God's ability. God's faithfulness is always perfect. We struggle, we have that mix of belief and unbelief, but thanks be to God. Jesus Christ, the scripture says, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he was faithful yesterday, he'll be faithful tomorrow. We invite you all over the building to stand as you're able, and we want to extend the invitation this morning, the invitation and the opportunity. Maybe someone came today and they're struggling with a bit of belief and unbelief. You're looking at circumstances, you're looking at how things are going. and you feel like that father, good news is Jesus worked it out for him. Remember, it's not about the size of your faith, it's about the focus of your faith. If you're here today and you desire to become a part of this church, maybe you've never been baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we invite you today. If you've made that spiritual commitment but you don't have a church home in Durham, our doors and our hearts are open to you today. And I wouldn't want to leave this morning without being connected to that power. It makes a difference. It makes a difference as the ensemble sings today. Be connected.
There's a touch from you. No one else can do the things you do.
God bless you, brother. God bless you. God is moving, church. A touch from him.
Is a touch from you.
Touch.
All I need is a touch from you.
Anybody need a touch from the Lord today?
No one else.
No one else. Somebody needs a touch. Somebody needs a touch.
All I need.
You're a candidate for baptism.
A touch from you.
Come on, your own Christian experience. Just sing the first part of that one more time.
Is a touch from you.
I don't want to leave anybody out. Don't leave anybody out.
No.
You're expecting someone else to show up. He's already here.
And make it right. All I need is a touch from you.
All I need, all I need.
All I need is a touch from you.
Church, we're grateful today for candidate for baptism and another coming to join on our Christian experience this morning. God is good, church. God is good. There are others desiring prayer, interceding for friends, and asking God to be on top of all the details of our life and visit all the hospitals and those who are ill. Let us go to God in prayer. Everlasting and ever loving and ever living God, you are wonderful and you fill us with wonder. Forgive us, God, for taking you for granted, for thinking about you and not thinking anything special at all. God, we thank you for being amazing. We thank you for being always on time, for being wiser than we can comprehend. And so we pray now, especially for these who have come down for special prayer. We know there are prayers being uttered under voices right now, even in the pews, even at home on sofas and couches, even in rest homes and nursing homes, God. They're praying right now, praying right along with us, God, and we are praying along with them. God, we pray that you would be on top of our issues. You would go before us this week. That you'd work things out better than we could even possibly imagine. Give us the strength that we stand in need of, oh God. Give us the support. Give us the help. Give us the wisdom. God, there's someone in ICU right now who's standing in need of a touch from you. And while they stand in need of a touch from you, their family stands in need of a touch from you. And so, God, we know that you have the ability to be in every place at the same time, by hospital beds and in living rooms of our homes. And so we thank you for that, that right now you are speaking words of life and hope and encouragement. And God, we thank you for the faithfulness of this one standing in the gap for a friend. We pray for her. We pray with her. We know that even right now, the Spirit is making utterances and groans that words cannot express. We know that Jesus is whispering in the ear of the Father, calling that friend's name to work it out, to work it through, to help her get over, and to let her know not only does she have a God who loves her, she's got a friend who stands in the gap with her. Not everybody can say that. And so we thank you. We bless you. We count it a joy. Praise you for the one who gave his life to you today, and the one who will come to join with us on her Christian experience. This we pray and ask in Jesus' name, and the people of God who love God said amen and amen. Amen. Let's thank God together today. Amen. 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 You can yeah, God is good, church. God is good. Say a prayer. My son is fine. He's in Thailand. So every now and then I think about it, and it's a little bit farther than I can get to with four wheels. So, amen. Amen. God speaks every language, and so, you know. Amen. We're grateful. We're grateful. Let us look to the Lord. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, now and forevermore. And the people of God said amen.